Today's video is going to be kind of different. I'll be putting together a circuit for a powerful battery-powered LED light, but first I want to show you what inspired me to make this video. You see, one of my goals here on YouTube is to provide accurate and helpful information through my DIY projects and other videos. But it's frustrating when I see videos like this one. It's supposed to show you how to make a super bright LED flashlight, and it's got over 4.3 million views, so it has to be good, right? Nope, it's actually full of things you shouldn't replicate, and the circuit they show isn't going to work for very long. It could even be a bit dangerous. So let's go through the video together and point out the things that should have been done better. After that, I'm gonna give you my suggestion for an easy, battery-powered, powerful LED circuit. The first thing we see is a 3.7 volt battery, probably rechargeable lithium polymer, and it's being glued to a piece of wood. Not as bad as the things you're about to see, but still not recommended. The battery is now very difficult to separate from the piece of wood in case it has to be recycled or repurposed. Always try to have a compartment for your battery. Don't just leave them exposed like that, it's for safety. At least the battery looks very big, so it's probably capable of providing lots of power. Next we see 8 LEDs. No details are given, but I'm going to assume they are high power LEDs, 1 watt or more, because that's what they look like. Then we are shown a small circuit board. This is a common module, it's based on the TP4056 chip, and it can charge single cell batteries. Technically, it can be used to drive LEDs in constant current mode, but that is not how it's gonna be connected in the video. This must be a power switch, which is always good to have. And now the LEDs are being glued directly to the piece of wood. This is a really bad idea, and I'm gonna show you why. Here is a couple of 1 watt LEDs similar to the ones in the video. I've now soldered one of them to a heatsink and the other doesn't have one. I'm now setting my power supply to 300 milliamps. This should put almost a watt of power into the LEDs. As you can see, the LED without a heatsink is getting really hot. After 5 minutes, it reached close to a worrying 100 degrees. The LED with the heatsink is also getting warm, but it settled at around 60 degrees. Not ideal, but much more acceptable. Since heat is bad for LEDs, you should always use a heatsink, especially if you're dealing with more than a watt of power. The ones in the video do not have heatsinks, so if they get anywhere to full power, they'll get really hot and eventually burn out. To make things even worse, the LEDs in the video are practically connected directly to the battery, and there is nothing to limit the current going through them. So how much current they draw will be mainly dependent on the voltage of the battery. If we look at the datasheet for a similar 1 watt LED, we see that at 2.5 volts there is nothing going on. But at 3.5 volts, the LED is already at the limit of what it is made to handle. The chart looks very similar for a 3 watt LED. At 3.6 volts, it's already conducting as much current as it is designed to. Meanwhile, a battery like this one will have a voltage of about 3 volts when it's empty, and 4.2 volts when it's full. So a full battery can overload even a powerful LED. Let's see what that looks like. First, I will connect the almost empty battery directly to the LED. Because the battery voltage is very low, the current is not enough to cause any damage. But now, let's do the same with the full battery. And just like in the video, let's use the LED without a heatsink. Straight away, the LED starts glowing super brightly and the heat is rising quickly. After a few minutes, I can smell molten plastic and the temperature of the LED is way beyond any safe limits. If you take a closer look, you can actually see the plastic over the LED is melting. Another bad idea is to have a bunch of LEDs connected in parallel like this. Normally, you would at least put a resistor to limit the current. I'm gonna leave a link to a video that explains why pretty well. So why is the flashlight in the video working then? Well, the best guess that I have is that the battery they're using is not full, so it doesn't have the voltage to overload the LEDs. Also, I would not be surprised if the battery they're using is old and worn out, so it has high internal resistance, which together with the resistance in the button, the soldering connections and the wires may be limiting the current going through the LEDs. Still, this is definitely not the way you want to put powerful LEDs in a circuit. And now let's look at a safer LED circuit. I'll have the parts and shopping links in the video description. I'm gonna use the 1 watt LED on a heatsink, the same TP4056 battery charging module, and a single cell battery with a holder and wires. I'll be also using this adjustable LED driver. It can control the current going through the LED, and it works at up to 6 volts and 1.5 amps. Additionally, I'll be using a 10K resistor and a simple switch, and I'll be building the circuit on a small breadboard, with pin headers and jumper wire. First, I soldered pin headers to the battery charging module and placed it on the breadboard. This module has 4 connection points on one side, battery positive and negative, as well as your positive and negative outputs. The USB port on the other side is for charging the battery. Then I connected the battery holder, making sure that I got the polarity right. Just to be safe, the battery isn't yet in place. Next comes the LED driver. It has 4 connection points, voltage in, output to the LED, an enabling pin, and ground. The positive side of the LED gets connected to the output pin of the driver, while the negative goes to the negative output of the battery module. Here I am connecting the power switch. The middle leg is connected to the voltage in pin of the driver, while the left leg goes to the enabling pin. The 10K resistor is connected between ground and the enabling pin. It functions as a pull-down resistor. Just a few more wirings to go. Now I'm connecting the ground of the driver to the negative output of the battery module, and the positive output is connected to the voltage in terminal of the driver. I am now turning a small potentiometer on the driver counterclockwise to make sure it is set to its lowest setting. After that, it is safe to put the battery in the holder and test the circuit. And we have success! Here is a wiring diagram for everything I just showed, and you can pause the video to take a better look. Now, the LED is working, but we're only using about 15% of its potential. So why not increase the current going through it to get more light out of it? You do that by placing a multimeter in series with the LED to measure current. Turning the potentiometer clockwise increases the current, and therefore the brightness. Each LED is going to be slightly different, but you should hit 1 watt somewhere between 300 and 350 milliamps. And of course, you don't have to run the LED at full brightness. Reducing the current will produce less heat and make the battery last longer. Leave your questions down below, and I'll see you in the next one.